So through this whole process, I'm the one that felt like I'm just getting hurt over and over again. And the fact that nothing is gonna be done is heartbreaking. I called, I reported it, and nothing has happened. I go to work every day, and I hear the whispers. But time and time again, this has been going on since October, and this is what I'm getting. And I'm told there's nothing anybody can do to help me. This individual may come back to work, and what am I supposed to do?
Hello, everyone, and welcome to the Anatomy of a Hate Crime Forum. We're here today to discuss what constitutes a hate crime, what happens when it crosses a certain threshold, what the investigatory and prosecutorial process might be with respect to that, and then to answer any questions that you might have beyond the information that's shared here today. We happen to have a superstar panel here today. These are the best and brightest in their respective agencies that I've met. So I guess I'll qualify that so none of you go home and get in trouble. Okay. And I'll accept all my payments at the end of the forum. But at any rate, we are very, very, very much privileged to have this information. This will be taped and rebroadcast. And there will also be a link available on YouTube so that during your leisure, you'll be able to view this as well. My name is Greg Murray. I'm the executive director of the Michigan Advocacy Organization. We are a statewide organization, but based here in Macomb County. We pursue the interests of African Americans, Hispanics, Latinos, our Arabic friends. We also advocate on behalf of children, veterans, seniors, and other what used to be called special needs populations. And so with that, I'd like to introduce you to our moderator, and that is Deidre, I'll say the whole name. Okay, Deidre Avon Mike McGee. There'll be a test on that later on. She is a conciliation specialist for Region 5, the Detroit Field Office of the Department of Justice. If you would please come forward. Yeah, I have to hold it.
Thank you, Greg. Good evening, everyone. It's my honor and pleasure to be here to open up this community forum and to give you a bit of introduction to the Department of Justice Community Relations Service. We're known as America's peacemakers. We go into communities where there is high tension, where there is stress, where there is conflict, or the perception of violence and or conflict in 8 jurisdictional areas mandated by Congress: race, color, national origin from the 1964 Civil Rights Act. And then in 2009, we were mandated 5 additional jurisdictions: gender, gender identity, sexual orientation, religion, and disability. So we have 8 jurisdictions and they can cross. They can be race and gender, they can be race and religion, they can be religion and gender. It doesn't matter. As long as it's jurisdictional, then I have to respond. Now, of course, responding depends on a number of things. Some instances, the response may not be as critical as others. For example, I handle casework in Michigan and Ohio, but oftentimes I have to go to other places like Baltimore, like Stanford, like Cleveland, places where real critical things have occurred: the shooting of a young boy, fatal shooting by a police officer, or the fatal shooting of someone who is unarmed, even here in Dearborn. So those are the types of cases that I have to work with. Those are the very high end, but we have other types of cases. And as you can tell from things going on around the country, if you're paying attention to the news and that, there's a lot of work to be done. And so the reason that we're here this evening and the reason I worked with Greg to help facilitate this particular meeting is that hate crimes perceived by the community as hate crimes occur, but they are not necessarily hate crimes according to state or federal jurisdiction. That's confusing for the average person. It's confusing for us. So we have to go by what the jurisdiction is and what the parameters are for that particular definition, whether it's state or whether it's federal. So this evening, representing the Department of Justice Community Relations Service, I'm going to help Greg with this community discussion about hate crimes. And before we go any further, I want to take some time to just broadly have the panelists introduce themselves. They are subject matter experts in this area. And so when they give you information, they're talking to you about how, as Greg said, they prosecute a hate crime or a crime that the community believes is called a hate crime. My agency does not prosecute. We don't point the finger. We don't place blame. The key word in Department of Justice Community Relations Service is community. And so I work to bring together community, law enforcement officials, local leaders, superintendents of schools, any leadership, any official, to help solve, resolve, bring peace, lower the tension in communities across the country, but more specifically, the Midwest Region 5-6 states.
Thank you, Deidre. Good evening, everyone. My name is Daniel Lemish, and I am the acting United States Attorney for the Eastern District of Michigan. And what that means is I am the federal prosecutor that handles all federal crimes in this area. Tonight, I'm happy to discuss the federal hate crimes that we have responsibility for, to let you know that these are crimes that we willingly will bring on behalf of people who are harmed by someone taking action against them because of their race, their religion, their origin, their sexual orientation. These are crimes that we take very seriously, and we apply them as best we can on your behalf. All of our cases need to be investigated by an investigative agency, and seated to my left is Jeff Downey from the FBI, and we work very closely together to determine whether a federal hate crime has been committed and whether a prosecution can be brought.
Good evening. As Dan Lemish said, my name is Jeff Downey. I'm the Assistant Special Agent in Charge for the FBI here in Michigan. One of my responsibilities as the Assistant Special Agent in Charge is to oversee our civil rights programs and investigations throughout the state. Prior to becoming the Assistant Special Agent in Charge, I was the supervisor of our public corruption and civil rights squad, so I'm intimately familiar with our civil rights program. And tonight we will talk a little bit about how we investigate those cases and how we work in partnership with the U.S. Attorney's Office and the Department of Justice Civil Rights Program out of Maine Justice to investigate and prosecute these cases.
Good evening. My name is Sean Lobar. I'm a special agent with the FBI based here in our Detroit office. I work under Mr. Downey. And I am one of the agents on our public corruption and civil rights squad, who's one of the people actually going out and doing the investigations for hate crimes and any other kind of violation that falls under that program.
Good evening. My name is Mark Bishop. I wear a couple different hats. Professionally, I work for the Michigan Department of Civil Rights and Community Relations Division, where I'm the strategic partnership coordinator. And part of that job is, as my name badge up here would indicate, providing the administrative support for the Michigan Alliance Against Hate Crimes, which is a statewide coalition collaborative of local, state, federal practitioners, both in law enforcement and at the community service level, be they advocates, be they service providers, dealing with prevention and response strategies around hate and bias.
Good evening. My name is Dean Allen. First, I'd like to say it's my pleasure and honor to be here. Thawview. I'm currently chief of warrants in the Macomb County Prosecuting Attorney's Office under Eric Smith. I've been an assistant prosecutor for 36 years. I'm the longest serving prosecutor in the building, in the office. My duties as chief of warrants is I supervise and I review most of the police reports that become warrants, crimes from the Macomb County Prosecutor's Office. Greg Murray asked me to come here. I've met Greg Murray numerous times before. I was one, and you'll find out, I was one of the parties that was involved in this noose case, and he asked me if I would like to attend. It was my honor. I'm sure you have some questions. I'll be more than happy to try and answer all your questions. Just like Dan at the end of the table, he's works with the federal authorities. I'm a state authority, so my jurisdiction is basically Macomb County, Michigan. Thank you very much.
The inspiration for this forum involves an incident which occurred on October 12th of 2016. There was a young African-American female who worked in the control room of the Macomb County Juvenile Justice Center. She went on a break and was relieved by several individuals, two individuals actually. When she came back from her break, the two gentlemen left the room. She needed to use a computer, so she turned to her right and saw a noose-like figure, toilet tissue, white toilet tissue wrapped in cellophane tape, and then a body inside the actual noose itself. She immediately reported it to her supervisor, who then went up the chain of command with respect to the organization of the Juvenile Justice Center. The noose was turned over to the Macomb County Human Resources Department, and they launched their own internal investigation. On or about December 9th, the results of the investigation were made known to her through a letter that she received in the mail. The letter was very brief and indicated that the county could not find any violation of the county's personnel policies. However, they did document an unprofessional exchange. Receiving that letter left more questions than answers for Ms. Brown, Andrea Brown, and she reached out to the Michigan Advocacy Coalition for assistance. I then immediately had her accompany me to the Macomb County Sheriff's Department, where a formal complaint was made. Shortly thereafter, the county executive, as a result of a conversation that he and I had regarding this incident, instructed his human resource director to contact the U.S. Attorney's Office to ask for assistance in conducting the investigation. There were two principals involved in the investigation from that point forward: a representative from the FBI and also a representative from the Detectives Bureau of the Macomb County Sheriff's Department. They conducted their investigation for approximately 2.5 months. Roughly 2.5 months. On March 2nd, a confession was garnered from one of the employees at the Juvenile Justice Center. That person was put on paid administrative leave and is on paid administrative leave as I speak right now. The case was referred to the Macomb County Prosecutor's Office, which did their due diligence and which confirmed that statutorily, the incident that occurred with her does not rise to the threshold of the Michigan statute for ethnic intimidation. And so we are here today to find out just what these various statutes might contain and what happens when that threshold is crossed, what protocols are engaged to investigate, and if warranted, to prosecute. There are a number of people who consider a noose being left behind an African-American female's desk by a white male employee a hate crime. That is probably based on the history of the use of nooses for lynchings and other nefarious activities. And so there is a level in the Michigan Advocacy Coalition's mind that there is intimidation, a need, a desire to instill fear and uncertainty with respect to the placement of a noose in a workplace shared by an African-American, either female or male. And so, again, what we're here to ask is we're here to ask the experts to share with us their definition of a hate crime, what their statute allows them or limits them to do with respect to proceeding forward, both with an investigation and or a prosecution. And at the end of this forum, you will hear from the young lady who found the noose behind her chair. And so I would then like now to pass it on to Dan Lemish so that he can share some additional information regarding their definition and what they do when they're engaged.
Thank you very much. Good evening again. I would like to talk to you just for a minute or two about the three federal statutes that are what are most commonly referred to as hate crime statutes, federal hate crime. The first is the Shepard-Byrd Hate Crime Act, and what that prohibits is the use of force or the attempted use of force on someone because of their race, religion, national origin, or sexual orientation. Use of force or attempted use of force, that it doesn't come into play when we're talking about hate speech. In other words, a swastika painted on a synagogue, a pig's head left at a mosque. That's not use of force or attempted use of force. It's horrible, horrible, vile speech. But it doesn't implicate Shepard-Byrd. For that, you need force or attempted force. And you have to prove that it was only because of the victim's race, religion, national origin, that use of force was used, that force was used. So for example, if the defendant is at a Tigers game and he's a white man and he's walking up the stairs at a Tigers game and an African American man is walking down the stairs and trips and spills a beer on the white man, and the white man might even use a racial epithet and haul off and punch the African American man. Was that use of force because of the victim's race, or was it because the victim spilled a beer on him? And all I want you to take away from this is it has to be the only reason that the use of force was used is because of the race, religion, national origin. It's a very difficult statute to prove, but it's a tool that we have in our arsenal. So that's one, Shepard-Byrd. Use of force or attempted use of force because of race, religion, national origin, or sexual orientation. And by the way, sexual orientation is something the federal statutes have, but the state doesn't, which I'm sure Dean will talk to you about. The second is the defacing of church property statute. And if someone defaces a house of worship, damages or defaces, because of the nature of the institution, that's a federal hate crime. But it has to be damage or defaces. And we've had cases where people have left a pig's head on the doorstep of a mosque. And if you don't know, a pig is a horribly offensive animal in the Muslim religion, the Islamic faith. Horrible, vile act. But unless it actually damages or defaces the institution, it's not a federal hate crime. So that's our second statute, the defacing church property. The third, and the one that I think might come into play most closely with the institute with the noose, is the threats in interference with federally protected activities statute. And that has to be either using force or a threat of force to either injure or, in our case most appropriately, intimidate someone to stop them from engaging in a federally protected activity. So use of force or threat of use of force to intimidate someone into not engaging in federally protected activity. Work is a federally protected activity. So intimidating someone to prevent them from working because of their race, religion, national origin, sexual orientation is a federal hate crime. So for the analysis of this noose case, we would need to analyze whether the leaving of that noose was either use of force or intended use of force to intimidate someone. That would be the question. This is used to protect people from blocking people's access to federally protected activities, like eating at a lunch counter, like staying in a hotel, like working, like going to school. Use of force or threatened use of force to intimidate them from stopping that. Those are the three broad statutes that we're dealing with tonight, and I'm sure we can continue that conversation about that.
I want to just talk briefly a little bit about what the FBI's involvement is when we have an allegation. So as Dan stated, these statutes are pretty clear, the use of force or the intended threat of force. Any case that we get into our office, a lot of times we have to judge, is it a hate crime or is it hate speech? And we don't make that judgment just by a phone call. Sean Lobar, who introduced himself, is a dedicated full-time civil rights coordinator in our office. We actively, aggressively investigate these allegations to determine if there was a violation of federal law or if it truly was just a hate speech. That process takes time. Those investigations, we do numerous interviews. It's not something that we take lightly. Once our investigation is done and we gather the facts to that, we not only deal with the U.S. Attorney's Office here in the Eastern District of Michigan or on the western side of the state in the Western District, but it's also reviewed by the Department of Justice civil rights attorneys in Washington, who are experts also that just focus in on civil rights cases. So there is a great deal of dialogue that goes as a result of our investigation and the information that we garnered from that investigation to determine if there is a violation of one of these laws. And I just want to add, that the Shepherd Byrd, Dan mentioned that briefly. Back in 2013, we had a case here in Detroit where a gentleman was in a BP gas station, and he was assaulted by another man by the name of Everett Avery, who ultimately pled guilty to that statute. And he was beat up in the gas station because of his sexual orientation. And I could tell you that there were a lot of work, a lot of time, investigatively went into that case to prove that there was a violation of that law. And at that time, there weren't many of those cases that were prosecuted nationally. And this is one of the first ones, I believe, in the country that was actually prosecuted. So, like I said, the cases take time. There's a lot of work that goes into them. But once we put that package together, we work in partnership with the U.S. Attorney's Office and the Department of Justice Civil Rights to determine if there is a violation of federal law.
But every time I read a police report, and what happens in Macomb County is basically same thing what the FBI just said or Dan said from the federal government, is that there's an investigation. The local police departments, they do the investigation. Once they get done with the investigation, if they determine that there may be a crime or may not be a crime, they fill out the police report and they bring it to our office. And sooner or later, I review a lot of these police reports. And I want you to know that we take, at least I take everyone serious, and I hope everybody in our office takes it, because by signing my name, I'm affecting someone's life. Either I'm arresting them or I'm not arresting them. And that's a great responsibility. So I want you to know I take it very seriously. And ethnic intimidation, I take very serious, as well as armed robberies, rape, murders, all the crimes. In the state of Michigan, for the state law, ethnic intimidation is a 2-year felony. Now I will read you basically the definition of ethnic intimidation, which is comparable to the federal law, except for that, the one Dan mentioned at the end about the intimidation. Under the state law, a person is guilty of ethnic intimidation, a 2-year felony, when that person has a specific intent to intimidate or harass another person based on the person's race, color, religion, gender, or national origin, and this is where it's very important, maliciously cause physical contact with that person, assaults the person, hits them, or damages or defaces that person's property. And that is the law in the state of Michigan.
From our perspective, we occupy the very unhappy middle ground between both of these sides. When an individual knows or believes that something has happened and it's not right, we are often the ones called upon to both answer that question, where should I go, who should I report this to, up to and including, I did report it, I'm not being taken seriously, there's questions about this, how does the system work? And we can often fill in that discussion, fill in that void, and talk about process and talk about system, and ultimately talk about outcome, sort of along the lines of how Deidre positioned it. It's not so much what statute I fall under or what side, state or federal, but how do we fix what has happened? One of the additional tools that we have within the department is the Elliott Larson Civil Rights Act. So that's actually a civil rights statute for purposes of an individual filing on a harassment claim or an employment-based decision that has taken place. That's separate and apart from any criminal prosecution or investigation that may take place regarding an incident. A lot of what we also focus on is that ground of it's distasteful, but it's protected. It's a situation in which there is no context or contact between the parties. What happens when the car goes down the street and someone yells a racial slur, or they're flying a Confederate flag? These things happen. They happen in schools, they happen in our places of employment, they happen in public libraries, they happen in our own homes. And we work towards bringing the appropriate individuals, be they state or federal prosecutors or investigators, your local police department, to that scene to take that report, but also work on the other side of it, of saying, why did it happen and how do we prevent the next one from happening? As was stated, this is very, very technical information. And one of the things that I brought in tonight was a handout, which is available on our website, on what to do when you find yourself either the target of or knowledgeable of someone that has been targeted based on their race, religion, color, national origin, sex, disability, height, weight, national origin, sexual orientation, gender identity. It's a long litany of things. The one thing that we always defer to in any of these situations is, if you're not a trained law enforcement professional, don't try and be one in that instance. leave it up to law enforcement. There are checks and balances in place that can address whether or not an appropriate investigation is conducted, whether or not an appropriate decision is made in a case. But you shouldn't be the one doing that at the ground level. We have to allow the professionals to do their job. We don't want to hinder what could be a very successful prosecution by being overly engaged in a situation where we're above our heads.
Mr. Downey, you had stated that under the Shepherd's Act, the three statutes, one was the threat of interfering with or the intent to intimidate. At this point, when, as an African American, if I was to see a noose and a body hanging out of that noose in my workstation, I would see that as intimidation. And I don't know whether that would fit under the state law, the federal law, or whatever, but somewhere along the line, all employees in the county are taught harassment, discrimination, and there's diversity training. I'm assuming, because having taught over 10,000 people at Ford Motor Company, I know most companies or entities want to say that my employees have been taught how not to act or react to situations. And to say that, having read the paper today, that there is no liability there for this person to do what he's done to the person that he did it to, it's unconscionable at this day and age. As an African American, if I was to come in and had a noose and something on my desk, I see that as racial intimidation, because nooses and things were done to African Americans. So when you see all of this, where's your stance? How is it, and how can we get these statutes updated? Because half the time, most of us thought that these things were in place for our protection, not our intimidation.
I want to say obviously, but under the state law, it's not a crime. Now, to get it amended, you have to go to your legislature and you have to pass a bill. Now, to pass a law. You understand? Okay. So even with trying to pass, even if the bill becomes law and it's passed, and there could be challenge on whether or not it's constitutional, the law, and it may not be a valid law, unless, because the courts have said, unless there's specifically, at least under state law, physical contact or malicious destruction of property. I mean, the protected speech, the thought you're thinking of something. It's not a criminal act under state law. Is it wrong? Obviously it's wrong. You know, we only have a panel to tell everybody it's wrong. But as far as federal law, I'll let Dan answer that. And matter of fact, so even, well, I have no idea what Macomb County is doing, but you have to understand that I denied the request maybe a week ago, so a couple of days ago. And so when I denied, I sent it back to the police department. So I do not know, I'm not speaking on behalf of Macomb County, I do not know if they have all the reports, because usually they don't get the investigation reports until I'm done with them. No one can get access to them. Victims, defendants, no one. So now maybe they have the reports. That's all I'm saying. We're done with the file.
Ma'am, first of all, I want to say how much I completely agree with you at how offensive this is and how intimidating this is and how unacceptable this is in the workplace or any other public place where people gather. The question is whether it violates federal criminal law. You said, is there no liability? There very well may be liability for creating a hostile work environment, in which case the victim of this could sue if it had been pervasive and the employer had allowed this to go on. But that's a civil remedy. That's not the government stepping in and putting handcuffs on somebody and potentially putting them in a jail cell. For that, the law is very specific. This is not just a crime that intimidates someone. That's not the crime. It has to be the use of force or the threatened use of force that ends up intimidating someone. Now, I suppose one could make a pretty plausible argument that a noose is a threat of force, particularly to an African American, considering our nation's checkered history as pertains to that. I can't tell you whether we would charge this specific crime. I can't, because the case is under investigation. So I can't publicly tonight tell you what we are going to do. What I'm telling you is what we would need to be able to prove beyond a reasonable doubt to 12 jurors unanimously. They would all have to agree that this was a threatened use of force. And for better or worse in this country, our First Amendment is a very, very powerful protection for people to engage in hate speech. And hate speech, as vile as it is not a crime. I'll give you one terrible example that I saw recently of a man who traveled across the United States with a T-shirt that said, F Islam, although it had the whole word spelled out. He wore a big old sidearm on his hip, and he carried an enormous American flag. And he stood on the sidewalks outside of mosques on Friday afternoons at the time of Friday prayer, wearing that horribly offensive shirt with a big gun on his hip. That was a gun that he had a license for. He wasn't breaking the law by wearing that gun. That horribly offensive epithet that he had on his shirt was protected speech. And although people of the Islamic faith trying to worship in their own way at their own house of prayer on a Friday afternoon were intimidated by this man, but it wasn't force or the threatened use of force, and therefore that was deemed to be protected speech. There are those horrible men from that Westboro Baptist Church that go to funerals of military men and stand there with horrible signs saying, you know, your son deserved to die, God hates your son, etc. What their theory is, I don't even want to even try to get into. Horribly hurtful, hateful speech to parents who are burying their children. It's speech. It is protected speech. It is not a crime. So again, I'm not passing on whether the noose on the back of the chair violated federal law. I'm just telling you what the base level is for us to bring a federal hate crime charge. Use or threatened use of force. That's not protected speech.
Thank you again. We have two cards here which pretty much say the same thing. One card says that the state statute needs to be changed, and asks the question, how can we change the state statute? The state statute can only be changed by the state legislature. The state legislature is sometimes impacted and motivated by citizens who call for changes in state statutes. And so one potential remedy for the narrowly defined definition of a hate crime is to work with your state representatives, both in the House and the Senate, and to engage other advocacy groups around the idea of upgrading, revising, and redefining this. There is a process out there. It is tedious. It takes a lot of work, a lot of intense advocacy, but there is a method available to help change that state statute, at least. The second question was to Dean Allen, and I understand, and he just referenced why he can't answer this question. The question on the card was, what is the county doing to ensure that this type of behavior is not condoned? Dean cannot answer that question. That question has to be asked of the county executive's office, which supervises the Juvenile Justice Center. There are some departments within the county that don't fall up under the authority of the county executive. However, the Juvenile Justice Center does, and perhaps engagement at that level can help inspire changes in their personnel policy manuals and personnel policies to create a consequence of some measure for this type of incident. As of right now, and this question also asks, are these policy changes in the works? We have no knowledge that they are. We have no knowledge that they are not. We're hoping that county government on its own, of its own volition, decides that something needs to be changed with respect to their policies. We did review the personnel policy manual that was provided to all of the employees. And nowhere in there is there a reference to a consequence to the type of action that was taken by this employee. We hope to engage the county at some point to advocate for that change, because it would be a shame if there were no administrative action which could lead to open questions regarding just how serious is the county with respect to acts like this.
One of the things, the message I want to let everybody know about is, and Sean mentioned it early on, if you think you are a victim of a hate crime, it's important that you reach out to us. If you think it's an immediate threat, call your local police department, but certainly call your local FBI office. Fortunately, here in Macomb, the FBI in the state of Michigan has 12 offices. We have 11 satellite offices, and one of those satellite offices is a resident agency, which is headed here by Matt Krupa. So, you know, I would highly encourage you, if you're a victim or if you know a victim, to contact us. You know, let us do the investigation. Let us look into it. Let us determine if it's a hate crime or if it's a hate speech. I can tell you that the civil rights program in the FBI, it's our one of our top five priorities. So we take these cases very seriously. We also have a very robust community outreach program at the FBI. Getting out and educating, talking to the community, having a dialogue is extremely important to us. So if you know of an organization here in the Macomb area that would have interest in the FBI, the U.S. Attorney's Office coming out and having further dialogue, we would love to do that. You know, it's education's a big part of this. A lot of times we find out that people who are victims of hate crimes don't come forward for a number of reasons, you know, for fear, for embarrassment. But if people don't come forward and people don't come and talk to us, then we can't do what we're supposed to do, and that's look into these matters and investigate it. So I can't stress that enough. We hear about things when we're out in the communities, that things that are going on, and, you know, when we ask, well, how come nobody's reported it? And we hear different reasons why people don't report it. But reporting is the key, that dialogue is the key. So I just want to stress that and let you know that, you know, there is a place to call, and that's the FBI or your local police department if you think it's an immediate threat. So thank you.
I would like to thank all of you for your time, for your concern, your passion, your questions as you brought them forward to us. And I want you to know that as far as the Community Relations Service of the Department of Justice is concerned, while there are many types of hate crimes that we cannot view as a hate crime, our agency has a different protocol, there are things that can be done, such as the dialogue this evening to educate and inform. And also that, as Greg had mentioned earlier about changing policies that are antiquated and so far outdated that they are not meaningful and don't handle situations that are really occurring almost every day in our society, CRS can help with that as well. This is nothing new. We don't have to reinvent the wheel. Many communities experience these issues. And there are best practices, resources, and references that can be brought to bear to help in that situation. I've offered those services already early on to Greg, and we will see what we can do down the road to help improve those practices and policies. There should not be a company that doesn't deal with these kinds of situations in their policy employee handbook or other guidelines that they have when you work for them. It's not anything that is difficult to do.
And so we'll end with what I call an impact statement.
Just to give you a little information about the incident, it was Wednesday, October 12th. I arrived to work at 2:45. I was a little early. My shift started at 3. I entered Central Control, which is the video room for surveillance for the entire facility. I was on light duty, so I got to work early, relieved the day shift staff, and began my day. Most of my shift went as usual. Everything proceeded normally. My first break was at 6 p.m. Shortly after that, I had someone else walk by the room. I knocked on the door and I said, "Hey, do you have a runner in your unit?" They said yes, and I said, "Can you please have them come to relieve me for a restroom break? It's gonna take me about 5 minutes," in which they did. An individual came in, relieved me for the bathroom break, and I went and also checked my phone to make sure everything was okay at home. Upon exiting the break room, I heard that there was an assistance call. When you work in Central Control, you have to make sure you notate the time and log in the book what time that call was made and to also repeat it over the radio. So when I heard it over the radio, that there was an assistance call, the individual that was covering me in Central Control did not repeat the call, so I repeated it. I returned to Central, gave them the radio back, and logged the book and watched the unit as everything transpired on that unit. A few hours passed, approximately 20 minutes passed when some other individuals walked by and said, "Hey, you okay? Do you need your second break?" Because we get 2 20-minute breaks. I said, "Yeah, come on in and break me." So the first gentleman that broke me for the restroom break was with this other individual. And the one that broke me for the restroom break said, "You know, I don't want you to want to go in there. I'm just getting back here. I'm not comfortable working in that room." So they came in together. I said, "I just need to get some tea. My throat is a little bit dry. I'll be right back." So I went out. Instead of taking a 20-minute break, I came back after 15 minutes. They were sitting there talking. I said, "No rush, go ahead, finish your conversation." I sat down and looked at the cameras. They got ready to leave. I opened the door for them, continued to look at the cameras, grabbed a chair, watching the monitors as I'm supposed to do. And then about 5 minutes later, I turned around to log onto the computer to see what youth were in which units and to see what was going on, because some of them have different things going on. The counselors and therapists notate different things in their records so you can see what's going on with that individual. And when I turned around and logged onto the computer, that's when I saw this noose hanging with a makeshift man hanging from it. And I actually sat there and stared at it because I just didn't understand it. I was shocked, very hurt, and just didn't know what to do. So I stared at it. And then I took a picture of it. I called a supervisor who had some new OJTs on the job training staff that were with them. And I asked them, could they come to Central Control? And the supervisor said, "Well, can you tell me what's going on?" I said, "No, you need to see this." I never touched it. I waited till the supervisor arrived. But just to back up, when that shift started, two supervisors entered Central Control at different times and nobody noticed anything. So I know that this didn't happen until after my last break. So once the supervisor came, I showed it to him. And he kind of just looked at it. He didn't touch it right away either. So he asked me who relieved me for my breaks, and I told him. He asked me, did I notice it before? I said, no. I said, when you came in here earlier, did you notice it? He said, no. Then he said, well, I know that some of the staff are working on Halloween projects with the youth from the West units. Maybe this is something that they're using. But what he didn't know is that the staff that came up with the Halloween projects idea the day before sent an email to all staff, and I commented on the Halloween projects and how I thought it was a great idea. Those projects included a headless horseman, Dracula, goblin, Frankenstein, things of that nature, and a werewolf. And so I said, I don't think so. So when I told him, I opened the email and I showed it to him and I read him off what was included in that email for that project. I said, this was not one of those things. So he took the item and said he would check it out. I didn't hear anything back the rest of that shift. I watched that supervisor walk out the door. I don't know if he reported it to administration or not. The next day when I came to work, I heard he did, but I wasn't sure. So it happened the same night I got forced to do overtime for an hour. So they called someone in to cover me so I wouldn't have to cover the whole shift. The person came in and I was walking out and I had a strange look on my face. So the midnight shift supervisor said, hey, Brian, what's going on? Are you okay? And I said, no. And they asked me what was wrong and I told them. And so they came into work during the day shift the next day and reported it to the director. I also let another supervisor know. They also went to the director. And later that day when I came to cover my shift, the first question I got asked by administration was, why did you tell somebody else? And it was like an attack to me because you made me feel like I did something wrong. I didn't do anything. I've always been nice to everybody, real pleasant, never mistreated anybody. So through this whole process, I'm the one that felt like I'm just getting hurt over and over again. And the fact that nothing is going to be done is heartbreaking. I called, I reported it, and nothing has happened. I go to work every day, and I hear the whispers. I hear people say she probably did it herself. I don't do anything to hurt anybody. I do the best I can to be the best person that I can be. I treat people fairly. But time and time again, this has been going on since October. And this is what I'm getting. And I'm told there's nothing anybody can do to help me. This individual may come back to work. And what am I supposed to do? Initially, it seemed as though it was a group of people working together. And I had one of these people that was assumed to be a part of it walking up to me every other day talking to me. But I have to come to work because I have a family. I can't afford to walk out on my job and quit. But I'm not gonna stop either because this is not right. And the strangest part of it all was when everything started happening after I got that letter in December from HR saying, hey, we can't corroborate your story, but there was an unprofessional exchange made. Nothing. February rolls around, it's Black History Month, and they happen to be covering the Emmett Till story, and I'm sitting in the classroom watching this and getting sick to my stomach. And yet and still, nothing is being done to help me. What are we gonna do? I teach my children to be right. I live in Macomb County. I've been considering putting my children in Macomb County schools. And how do I know that my child won't suffer something worse? Makes me feel like this is not a safe place. I moved across 8 Mile to get away from Detroit. My own people that are hurting themselves to come where it's supposed to be safer, but now I have a whole nother fear. I'm out here, so what's gonna be done to help me? Can anybody answer that? What's gonna be done to help me? I'm tired. I have gone to therapy because I couldn't sleep at night. I have called off work numerous days because I don't know what's going to happen. What am I supposed to do? What am I supposed to do? And I hear today almost let this person come back to work.
Well, that's the face of what I call a hate crime. Statutorily or not, to inflict severe emotional distress and anxiety on a person, to me, rises to the level of nothing else but a psychological hate crime. We're limited by state statutes and language, et cetera, and hopefully we will deal with that. But I wanted you to hear, and she's not concerned about presenting what happened to her for review during a lawsuit or anything else like that. There's nothing more harmful that can be done for her. The question done to her, the question is, what remedies are there in place now, or remedies that can be put in place to help her? So with that, I'd like to thank Mr. Lemish for attending from the U.S. Attorney's Office. I'd like to thank Mr. Downey for taking time out of your very busy schedule as the acting special agent in charge of the FBI. Sean, I really appreciate you coming. We've met and we've talked before. Mark, I look forward to your enlightenment and maybe some assistance with respect to how we go forward in this regard. And Dean, I want to thank you for being who you have been since I've known you. Straight up, matter of fact, but at the same time has shown empathy for a person in her position. And so with that, I would like to ask all of you viewing this to contact your legislators to advocate for a change in the ethnic intimidation laws in the state of Michigan. And again, on behalf of the Michigan Advocacy Coalition, I thank you all for your time, and be blessed and safe going home. Thank you.